Can you see this?
Yeah, universe as we know it.
Yeah, good.
Google Hangout, July 25, 2015, Krishna Das Kulkarni. Perfect.
Okay, so you can see it and you can also read it.
Yeah.
That's good. What we will do here is, we will just talk about the large-scale universe as per modern science.
Okay, perfect.
The reason I qualify is that there has been notions and ideas and theories about universe. There still are across all times and all cultures, because it seems there is an innate need for us to have some notion of the universe. It's probably one of the fundamental needs once you satisfy the need for food and other physiological needs and cravings. So you go to Aborigines in in Australia, or some tribes in the deep jungles of Africa, or the Eskimos, or the Native American Indians, or anybody, you will see that there are theories of universe, and it serves its purpose. At least it connects people to the universe and gives them a place. But the modern times are slightly different, in the sense, in a scientific and intellectual society, there is more demand on observational and scientific validity of the theories we hold in our mind, or whatever picture we hold in our minds. So this is the approach we will take: what stands to test and what stands to observation from a scientific point of view. Because this is science, the only thing it assures is that whatever story science tells today will be different tomorrow. That's the nature of science. But as we know today, this is probably the most coherent story. All right. Another thing I want to say is, I don't think that you all will learn a lot of new things here, but probably there will be a few new things. But my hope is that maybe all the pieces will fall in place much better, and this will give a much better perspective of most of what you already know, along with some new information. So ask questions, or I will ask you.
Great. As far as possible, you avoid asking questions to us.
Yes, the way you can prevent me from asking questions is you can.
You want to measure how we conceive the idea you deliver.
Yeah, because this is a small audience, so there is no need to be.
Yeah, perfect. Okay. It was kidding, like, you know.
Yeah, that's. So, one of the first things that we need to understand and get a feel for or appreciate is the scale of the universe and how it looks. Typically, that is hidden from us. When we see a picture like this, you know, you take a picture of Jupiter and you can see Jupiter filling the whole screen, or filling the whole page of a magazine that you're looking at, or Saturn. But it doesn't give you a sense of the space involved, even in the solar system, and how big space is, and how small these structures of matter are. So we'll just try to get a hang of it to begin with, okay? That's the first thing. Before we go to the next one, right? So I don't know if you can see me, but let me just switch to camera.
Okay. Yeah.
So let's say this is the sun. Okay, this is about 1 foot my extended palm is about 9 inches, and another 3 inches, maybe a little more. So if this is the sun, or sun is the size of this object, right? We want to get a sense of solar system and the planets, okay? I'll just hold something slightly bigger than the Earth in my hand. Having a little bit of trouble getting it.
It's okay. It's okay. It's okay.
I don't know if anyone can see this.
not even properly visible, it seems. Very.
This is malli. So what's it called? Coriander.
Coriander. Right? Coriander bean.
If you hold it lengthwise, it's a little longer, but widthwise, it is still a little bigger than Earth. Okay. Now, I will try to keep it at the proper distance from the sun. Okay. So I can walk backward. Maybe you won't hear me.
Oh, this is distance-wise.
Can you see this?
Yeah. No, we cannot. I mean, you can see. We can see the hand. See your hand. That's it.
Okay.
Your hand that's holding the coriander seed. That's it.
So that's about 35 feet or something.
Okay.
And about three times that distance is where Earth is.
Oh, three times.
Yes. It's about 100 feet or 109 feet. So it's practically invisible.
So according to sun, Earth is insignificant according to sun. Correct?
Size-wise and then distance-wise also. If you
even distance-wise.
Yeah, it's a small speck. Okay.
Insignificant.
Now now the biggest planet is Jupiter.
Yeah.
That's about 1 inch in diameter. This is a bottle cap. I haven't painted it or anything, so I just want to show the size. Okay. This will be about 520 feet.
So
distance.
Distance-wise.
Yes. So the size of Jupiter will be this, and it will be about 520 feet.
That is also very trivial according to sun. Yes. Size-wise and distance-wise.
And it may be in a different direction. It's not that all planets are aligned in a straight line, right?
Yeah.
So you can just imagine how far is 520 feet, and there is nothing else in between. Now you can imagine Mercury about 40 feet away, but that's practically invisible because it's like the tip of a pin.
Yeah.
And you can imagine all other planets also, but basically the entire thing is empty space. Okay. So the sun will be here. And then about 100 feet away in one direction will be that small particle, this thing.
Yeah.
And about 520 feet away will be this in another direction. And about 1,000 feet away, something of this size or a little smaller will be Saturn in another direction. Yeah. Oh, that's all. And Pluto, if you want to think about it, will be 1 kilometer away. And it's 1/4 the size of Earth. So. There is no way to see.
You cannot even show the size by holding in your
hand.
Maybe some mustard seed or something like that. No, not even mustard seed.
Yeah. So that is the space in the solar system, right? Now, let's take the night sky.
SLA.
What is that?
SLA man.
Uh-huh.
Could I ask you one question that these planets are in different planes, no? They are moving in their own planes, and it is not in a co-centrical plane, like whatever Earth is rotating the sun, it's in a plane, for example. And it is not necessarily be the other planets as well. They are also rotating in the same plane. It may be X, Y, Z, maybe different planes?
All the planets are nearly coplanar. Their orbits lie in the same plane.
It's a coplanar like.
I don't know what you mean by coplanar.
I mean plane.
Yeah, so all the planets will be are practically in the same. There is a few degrees of difference.
Okay.
But they are all in the same plane around Sun.
I was under the notion that these planets are, you know, in different planes, like X plane, Y plane, Z plane. No.
Not exactly. There are objects which are at a high inclination, but most of the planets go around the Sun practically the same.
In the same plane.
Same plane. There are a few degrees of difference.
Okay. Okay.
But things like asteroids, things like comets, even Pluto, they are at a high inclination. And comets can come even in random directions.
Yeah.
All around.
Yeah, got it.
Planets are mostly in the same plane.
Okay.
And it's an ellipse, and the ellipse will have Sun as one, at one focus.
Sun as?
Sun will be at one focus of the
one focus, okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
And the other focus, there is nothing. Okay. So ellipse has two foci, right?
Yeah.
So one focus has the Sun in it, and the other focus has nothing in it, but it has some interesting properties. Yeah. It's different. Even comets, which take a very long time to visit the inner solar system, they have very elongated ellipse, and it can be in any kind of inclination. But they also have the same, you know, Sun is at one focus and the other focus is somewhere far away. Right. So let's switch back to the night sky. So this is a beautiful view of night sky. You can see this is the Milky Way, the band of Milky Way. Obviously, this picture is taken from a dark sky location. I don't know whether this was taken in Australia or Arizona somewhere. I don't know. I don't remember. I used to remember.
Do you have similar pictures in your archive, which has been taken with your telescope, own telescope?
No, I'm not into photography or imaging. I do mostly visual. But there are a lot of friends do this, and you know, we can get enough pictures. Yeah. And there are pictures that show, you know, they are mind-boggling pictures. So these are, each dot is a star. So when you look at the night sky, you see a lot of stars, and things are very bright, right?
Yeah.
But what we want to understand is this really true? Is this showing us something, or is it hiding more, right?
Yeah.
So let's just look at the nearest star compared to the Sun in the same scale. If this is the Sun, right?
Yeah.
We know that surrounding the Sun, practically, it is emptiness. There is nothing. You keep this in the middle of Sahara Desert. Okay.
Okay.
Because I want to give some sort of a perspective for emptiness or barrenness, but nothingness doesn't give any perspective. So maybe a desert will be a good idea. So leave it in the middle of Sahara Desert, and let's just see where the nearest star will be. Okay. So this is about 12 inches in size, right? The one light year will be, in this scale, about 1,200 miles. Okay. One light year is the distance light travels in 1 year.
That's
about 6 trillion miles.
Okay. Yeah.
The nearest star is about 4.5 light years from us, Proxima Centauri.
Oh.
So on this scale, the nearest star is about 5,000 miles, 5,200 miles, somewhere in that range, order of magnitude, in this scale. So if Sahara Desert is not big enough to show the position of the star. In fact, the entire African continent doesn't have enough length to show that.
Ooh.
I think if you keep this in Johannesburg, the nearest star will be in Singapore. Because I was just checking the flight distance. Yes. and there is nothing else in between.
Oh, amazing. Quite amazing. Unimaginable, like, you know, it's...
So that's just the vastness of space, right? And there are stars which are much farther away. You can see stars that are 10 light years away, 100 light years away, 500 light years away, 2,000 light years away.
Excuse me. Right. Excuse me, Babu. Excuse me. What could be the material field in between these two stars from Johannesburg to Singapore? What could be the material? Like, is it ether? What's that? Is gaseous or...
The idea of ether was thrown out more than 100 years ago.
Yeah.
So there is no such thing. It is basically empty space. But there is usually some radiation and stellar wind particles that are charged particles that fill this. It doesn't fill, but they just roam the space. Like the solar wind.
Okay.
The sun emits light. The sun also emits charged particles as stellar wind.
Like protons and some nuclei. Is it implies that some attraction repulsion is happening there?
No.
Maybe.
No. We should think of it as empty.
Empty.
Yes. Usually empty, but you know there are some regions where there can be a cloud of hydrogen gas or some other gas that has come out of stellar explosions.
Vast, huge, empty
space.
Yeah, it is
just emptiness otherwise.
Vastness. Yeah. Empty vastness.
So now if you go back to that night sky, you can just wonder the distance between each of these dots. You know, this is a 3D picture which is projected onto a two-dimensional surface, right? That's our night sky.
Okay.
Because things are at different distances, right?
Okay.
And just imagine the vast distances that separate these dots. To us, it looks like the night sky is filled with stars, but actually it is filled with emptiness. We just can't see it because of the bright dots.
Yeah. Yeah, got it.
Okay, so I think that is the picture we should hold for a little while when we think of the large-scale universe. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, this is another perspective. If you compress the entire solar system to the size of a quarter coin, this is a US quarter. Okay. Our galaxy will be the size of the entire North American continent. Our galaxy is, you know, it is in extent, it's about 100,000 light years. And at the bulge, it's up something like 10,000 light years thickness at the bulge. But it's 100,000 light years distance. Okay. And it has got these nice spiral arms, gas clouds, where stars form, and all that. But size-wise, that's out, you know. There's nothing more to show there. Okay.
Yeah.
And each of these, you know, what looked like bright cloud is actually each of them are stars. Each dot is a star. Okay. This can get boring quickly just looking at the size of it. So here are some galaxies that we can see using even somewhat modest telescope. These are different sizes and shapes. It shows a lot of gas clouds and dust lanes and all that. This is a bright core of the galaxy, major spiral arms. Okay. It shows big spots here, big bright spots. They must be clusters of stars or huge star-forming regions. But otherwise, every brightness that you see here must be star. And it looks pretty continuous, but we should imagine that there is a lot of space that separates that brightness between each, you know, microscopic specks. This will be stars.
What is that glowing at the center of the galaxy?
The center of the galaxy is very active. There is a lot of, there's a high density of stars there. And typically all galaxies have a huge black hole also. something of the size of the mass of a few million suns. So the center of the galaxy is really shines bright.
Yeah.
You can see this in the next picture. This is a very beautiful galaxy. All these, you know, I'm just showing you pictures of some galaxies that you can see if you go to an observatory or if you buy a telescope.
This is the same picture you have taken in some other from some other angle.
No, this is a different galaxy. We don't have the degrees of freedom to change perspective when it comes to looking at these things. So you can see this warp edge. Obviously, we are looking at it edge on. The other one we were looking at face on. This is edge on.
Yeah.
And you can see the core of this galaxy is very bright. Yeah. You can't really see it because it's blocked by this.
This is also seems to be in a spiral form, but in a singular spiral.
We can't see the spiral structure here because we are looking at it head on. I mean, edge on, like looking at Saturn edge on, right? You don't see the structure of the rings, right? You just see a thin slice there. If you look at it face on, you will see structure. Here is another galaxy, Sombrero. It's a beautiful galaxy. It's like
amazing.
Sombrero is a Mexican hat. You can see that, you know, there is a disk. It's pretty much the same structure for a lot of galaxies. You will see that there is a flat disk, either in spirals or somewhat of an elliptical or elliptoid shape. And then there is a central bulge. So just a sample of some galaxies you can see. Okay, here, so these galaxies are shaped by the strength of gravity because it just pulls matter. Gas clouds are pulled in to form stars and stars assemble to form galaxies. So huge masses of gas, right? They form these structures and it's just the act of gravity that forms all these. And then gravity keeps on assembling larger and larger structures of mass. Like these are this is a cluster of galaxy, huge cluster. Ooh. Yeah, most of these fuzzy things are, all of these fuzzy things are huge galaxies. Some are elliptical, some are other shapes, some are irregular shapes. The irregular shaped galaxies are younger ones or some are smaller ones. They get ripped apart by others. But they are all pulled together by the force of gravity. You can see there are probably thousand galaxies or something like that. And this bright spot here is a star. It must be a foreground star in our galaxy. We cannot see individual stars in other galaxies. Well, using very powerful telescopes you can, or with smaller ones you can see stellar explosions like supernovae, but we can't see other ones. So cluster. Here is a super cluster.
Okay.
Now you can see some arcs of light here. Can you see this?
Yeah.
And you can see around here.
Yeah.
These arcs are light that is bent by the extreme gravity of this cluster.
Like a dark hole phenomena.
No, this is called gravitational lensing.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Because this,
where gravity is more light, light will dilate. Not dilate in the sense it will.
So this the way you should look at it is, these stretched lines are images of galaxies that are lying behind this cluster.
Okay.
Light coming from the galaxies behind it, it gets bent by this, and it creates multiple images, and you know, it stretches it. And
amazing.
So this is a super cluster, and the mass here is tremendous. It's enough to bend these things and create these effects. Einstein had predicted this, and you know, we are watching it. Okay. So gravity is basically the architect of the universe, if you want to think about it. So here is my favorite picture from Hubble Space Telescope.
Okay. Hubble Ultra Deep.
Yeah. It's called Hubble Ultra Deep Field. This is the size. You can see this. This is the size of this piece of sky.
Yeah.
If you look at the moon, it's a very small piece of the moon size. I don't recall, remember in degrees how much it is. I just, when I remembered it, I created this. Now, Hubble Space Telescope, it's a telescope that, you know, that's in space and it orbits the Earth. But the advantage is that it is free from interference from the atmosphere, so it can get very high resolution images of the sky. And it doesn't have night and day issues and all that. It's always looking away. Or you can turn it in any direction you want. So Hubble is very pricey real estate. People who want to do project or want time on Hubble, they need to submit their proposal, and there is a committee that evaluates the return on their proposal or the time that they need and what can come out of it. So there's a committee that decides. So it's always very tight schedule on Hubble.
Okay.
So, but the director of Hubble has some flexibility, because there can be some targets of opportunity where you might miss it. You don't have 1 year or 2 years of scheduling window for that. You know, something might just come by and you want some time on it. So the director has some flexibility there. So at one time, what the director, I don't recall who it was, what he did was, he said, hey, there is that empty piece of sky there. Why don't we just point Hubble there and ask it to stare at that spot, you know, for several hours and see what happens. It's able to find something.
Yeah. It's an empty space, basically.
Yeah, it's an empty, you know, empty region of sky. And so I don't recall whether this was an 80-hour or 90-hour or something like that. It just stared at it. So the advantage is it can collect light for such a long time. So many photons, right?
Yeah.
So it found this picture. This small frame has about 10,000 galaxies, as I said in the margin. Okay. And it is looking very far, at a great distance. The brighter galaxies and, you know, the ones that are more nicely shaped, they are nearby. But these fuzzy shaped things and irregular ones are younger galaxies that are far behind, you know, from the early universe, if you want to say. And these redder ones, they are even more distant. So the farther you look, you see, you go farther in time also. That's how you see the sky.
Okay.
I don't know if you are familiar with that idea. So if you look at the sun, you should never look at the sun, but you know, with proper filters or whatever, the sun you see is as it was 8 minutes ago, right? If you look at Jupiter, typically you might see it something like 40 minutes distance. So Jupiter as it was 40 minutes ago, or 50, 55 minutes, where it is, depending on where it is. If you look at the nearest star, it's as you see it as it was 4.5 years ago. If you look at the nearest galaxy, you are seeing it as it was 2.5 million years ago.
My God.
So you are always seeing a cross section of time. In fact, if you look at the person next to you, maybe, you know, Premada is sitting maybe 1 foot away from you, you are seeing her as she was nanosecond ago.
Yeah.
you're never experiencing that instantaneously. Yeah. And a Priyanka, if she's like 5 feet far from you, you're seeing her like 5 nanoseconds ago. That's a time lag. So the same thing, when you look at the sky, the farther you look, the younger the universe you see, or the farther you see in time also. That's how it is. So here, this picture actually has a very nice thing. I think it is this picture. Yeah. So let me show you this. You can check this out on the web. It's called the Hubble Ultra Deep Field, the UDF Skywalker.
UDF Skywalker.
Yeah. I'm going to fire up the browser now.
UDF.
UDF stands for Ultra Deep Field. Now, they have taken more images like this of different parts of the sky and come up with the same thing. And some of them are three-dimensional views. So here, the same picture that we saw, you can see on the left-hand side on the top corner. And there is this magnifying glass you can see here. Oh, no, I need to switch to this. You can see this. And as you move this magnifying glass, you can see the galaxy is magnified, right? Can you see this?
Yeah, of course.
And you're seeing a very young universe here. And this is an irregular galaxy. It hasn't formed into a nice shape. You know, the younger galaxies will be very irregular. And the mature ones will have more spiral structures. And the really mature ones will be more elliptical. It won't even have a noticeable spiral structure. But you can see these things. These are coming from a very early universe. You are seeing this as it was maybe 5-10 billion years ago. Some all kinds.
What are the color difference? Some orange, some bluish. Some
the color differences. That's a very good question. I didn't explain that. The farther you look, the redder it will appear.
Okay.
Because things that are coming from far, I think we are just getting a little ahead. They are moving away from us, farther and farther. You know, they're faster and faster. So their light gets red shifted. This is the same effect you see when a car is approaching you. You can see that the sound is getting a high pitch.
Okay.
And when it is moving away from you, the pitch will be lower, right? The same effect in light, when something is moving away from you, the pitch, which is the frequency, determines the color. And the lower pitch would mean more reddish color.
Yeah.
And a higher pitch would mean more bluish color. And you don't see any galaxies at a higher pitch or at a blue shift. You typically see red shift. And some of them, the most distant ones are shifted out of the visible spectrum. You need infrared and things like that. So you can spend some time looking at it, you know, all kinds of galaxies here. Look at this. It's like weird shapes, right?
Amazing, yeah.
There's about 10,000 galaxies here in this mall. Okay. So I'll switch back. This must be getting. All right, so that is a view. Now, how does it look on a large scale? Right, if you look at it maybe up to 100, 200 million light year scale, you see that the galaxies are assembled in a web structure, like a filamentary structure. So this is a survey of galaxies, I think 2 million galaxies or something like that. It's called the Sloan Digital Sky Survey. And this is the structure you see is how the galaxies seem to be assembled in a somewhat smaller scale, smaller scale would be, you know, up to 100 million light years or 200 million light years distance scale. And the big gap that you are seeing here, dark, that's not real. That's the region that we cannot see because our galaxy is getting in the way.
Okay.
But our galaxy is a huge bright thing, and you can't see anything beyond that if you look at the plane. So this filamentary structure is an intermediate shape. Now, if you really look at the large-scale structure, this is how the universe looks like. There is no structure. It's kind of uniform. Everything is uniform.
Yeah.
So these are all galaxies. Okay.
Billion light years.
Yeah, but here on Earth, when you look at the sky, you see the sun in one direction, moon in the other direction, or if it's night, you can see some stars here, some other stars over there. But the large scale universe, there is nothing. It is just uniformly filled with galaxies in all directions. It's a very smooth universe. So that's the large scale nature.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is the principle. It's the technical term is homogeneous and isotropic. So actually it's a little more than, there is a term for this, it's called the cosmological principle. A universe that is homogeneous and isotropic. You can actually go a little more than that. We know that the physics that we know works everywhere in the universe because we can see that the gravity works exactly the same way. Because you can see that, you know, stars orbiting their galaxies and the galaxies moving together with other galaxies or clusters in the same way we understand gravity. Looking at the light, we can see that, you know, stars are forming the same way, so nuclear physics is the same. You can see that absorption spectra and emission spectra, which means, you know, quantum and atomic physics is the same. So if you learn anything about science in your school here, you can pretty much apply it anywhere else in the universe. We're pretty much at home everywhere. Okay, so now that we have seen the large-scale structure, I think a little too much in detail. If we can move faster, just let me know. But if I'm too slow, this is where I don't know how much is new information versus how much is old information. Okay. So the universe is expanding. It has been expanding for a very long time. We got news about 80 or 90 years ago. This gentleman, Edwin Hubble, he was studying fuzzy objects in the sky. Until he came into the picture, the belief was that all the fuzzy nebulae stuff that we see in the sky belong to our galaxy. So our galaxy, Milky Way, was practically the whole universe. That was the belief in up to the early 1900s, prevalent belief. But he actually measured distances to a lot of those fuzzy objects, and he found many of them are much farther away from most of the stars, so they are probably not belonging to our galaxy. And they're also moving away from us. That was a shocking discovery. Okay. They are moving away from us in a way that the farther they are, the faster they are moving. That's what he found. It's called the Hubble law. Okay, so let's just look at it. So he basically said the universe is expanding. It is not that people always believed the universe is static, but for a long time that was the predominant view, that the universe is infinite and eternal, it doesn't change. But then a few hundred years ago, around the 17th century and 18th century especially, people started questioning, if the universe is infinite and it's been around forever and it is unchanging, why is the sky dark at night? That was a question. Will the sky be dark at night if the universe is infinite and unchanging? Anyone wants to think about it?
No. Well, it's probably no.
Probably no. Okay. So if the universe is infinite and it's eternal and unchanging, right? Let me just switch to this. If the universe is unchanging and infinite, every line of sight, when we look at the sky, every line of sight will end in a star.
Okay.
It's as big, it's as bright as the sun, at least, right? So if the universe is infinite, there must be infinite stars. Maybe they're locked up in infinite galaxies, but there are still stars, and stars are bright as the sun, at least as bright as the sun, or on an average. So every line of sight will end in a star. So the whole sky should be as bright as the sun. That was the argument. In an eternal and infinite and unchanging or static universe, we should have a night sky, the whole sky, as bright as the sun. This is called Wilbur's paradox. Okay, this is a German astronomer called Heinrich Wilhelm Wilbur. Olbers. Heinrich Wilhelm Olbers. So since we don't see the sky as bright as the sun, the universe cannot be infinite and unchanging and eternal. That was his. I mean, he was the one who formalized this argument, but long before him, other people had similar thoughts, right, from Copernicus or others. So, yeah, Aji, you want to ask a question, right? Because there are some questions typically you can ask here.
Actually, one of the questions I just wanted to ask you is, the first question is, see, you showed a wheel cup, like that, I suppose that's a wheel cup, car wheel cup, to show the size of the sun.
No, this is actually a...
Is this a wheel cup?
Plate.
No, plate. It's a plate. Okay.
Yeah.
See, we do have certain understanding about the universe, the whole entire universe, suppose. Our understanding with all the equipments and telescope and whatever you name it, we do have a certain understanding. And if you compare that understanding to the size of the sun, what could be the real truth, real universe, what we did not understand? What could be the, how you correlate these two? I hope you understand my question.
We don't know. There is always more to learn. There is always more to learn. The more you learn, the more questions you learn to ask. Right? There is always more to learn.
Our understanding is very limited. And you know, yeah. It is quite unimaginable, it seems, the vastness of the universe.
Yeah, absolutely. There is always things that we will have to learn. I don't know if we will ever understand everything, but we progressively, we try to learn progressively more and more, which also allows us to ask more questions, right?
More questions, yeah.
So, I was just getting back to the dark sky argument, okay? So one of the questions that people can ask is, well, yes, every line of sight may end in a star, but the farther away a star is, the dimmer it will look, right? So it may not look as bright as the sun, right? Because if something is twice the distance from its current distance, then the light that you will see will be four times dimmer, right? Because you look at a certain area, right? And when you increase the distance, the same light should fill four times the area, right?
Yeah.
If you, is that making sense?
Sure.
Because length and width, if you increase the size, then it should four times the area. That's one argument. So the answer to that is, that's true, but the same area will now contain four times as many stars.
Okay.
Right? So it's still be. And another thing you can think about is, what if there are dust and clouds of gas and things like that between stars and us? They can block the light, so the stars may look dimmer or they may not be visible at all. But then if the universe is infinite, the starlight has been shining on these dust clouds of dust and gas for so long that they will emit an equivalent amount of energy and they will shine like the stars. Right? So any way you look at it, if the dark, if the night sky is not as bright as the sun, it means that the universe cannot be infinite and eternal and static. That was the argument. Okay. You can read up more on this. You know. On
so what would you like to? Excuse me, Babu. What would you like to name this force behind the mystery of the universe, keeping the universe? Like these and the shapes and colors and distances and all these mysteries put together, what would you like to name it?
I didn't get the question. Can you ask that again?
See, what do you name it? The force, or you know, the element behind the vastness, the secrecy, the secret, and you know, the intricacy or ambiguous, whatever you name it. What do you call collectivity? Eastern culture, it is, they term it as God, or you know, Brahma, or what do you call it in science?
So I mean, that's the tough question. But there are some answers, but there are more questions also. So we'll come to that. Maybe we'll go through more of this stuff. We'll see what
so appears to be. This is standing very close to the spirituality the Eastern people had. Eastern people had once upon a time, some 5,000 years back, they had some idea. They had some. They calculated the distance between stars and sun, and you know, lot of things they had. So would you like to comment on this this particular point as well?
I think it's a good thing that if science and spirituality is finding common grounds, it's a good thing. There is no need for a conflict.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
There is no need for a conflict. They probably take different paths, but if they end up the same place,
yeah.
What more can you ask?
Yeah.
So, do you want to move on, or is there more comments?
We'll move on.
Okay. So, anyway, so let's take a look at the expansion itself. Okay. This is an explanation how, I mean, at least a demonstration of how this was found, or just the mechanisms of it and what comes out of it. So here are some absorption lines looking at some galaxies. You know, galaxies as elements, so let's say it's predominantly hydrogen, right? When you split the light coming out of the galaxy into its component frequencies or colors, then you will see that the certain elements absorb energies at certain frequencies. This is physics, right? So here are two absorption lines. I believe they are from, I don't know, I don't want to venture a guess, I forgot. which elements it's coming from. But the point is, the farther away a galaxy is, the lines seem to be shifting more and more towards the red side of the spectrum.
To the right-hand side.
Right, that is towards the red side. But the element always absorbs the same frequency. So the fact that it seems to be shifting to the redder side of the spectrum means that the light coming from there is getting redshifted, you know, going towards the higher side of the, I mean, lower side of the pitch, like it's moving farther and farther away. So what Hubble did was he plotted the apparent speed with which these things are moving away from us against the distance that he calculated for these. And he found that there is a sort of a linear relation there. The farther away something is, the faster it is moving away from us.
Okay.
All these galaxies, except for the very, you know, closest galaxies, all the others seem to be moving away from us. The farther away they are, the faster they are moving away from us. So now you can ask, so is the Milky Way some stinking galaxy or something where nobody wants to get close, they all want to move away from us?
Really amazing. This topic is very amazing and very vast, and you know, it's very quite deep also.
This is very interesting, right? I mean, this was very surprising. Nobody thought the universe was expanding, and I'll tell you, even though we'll talk about
would you like to say that there should be a force behind all these things, force, which is, you know, holding all these things together. So would you like to say this is a single force or multiple force?
So
what is your judgment on this?
At the large scale, it seems it is gravity, but we'll come to this. There are more mysteries to the universe, actually. So we don't want to jump to the conclusion that something is holding it together. We'll come to that. There is a lot more.
Spirituality says that this the single force, it has desire to, you know, develop further, and that desire has condensed and it has become a small thing and it exploded. So I heard, and you know, it's absolutely connected with Indian spirituality, Eastern spirituality.
Right.
So the force, it has some.
A lot of scientists are also deeply spiritual, but somehow I think. Quite often, it is up to the individuals to bring these things in agreement, right? And so it's amazing. Einstein himself was spiritual.
Yeah, and then Stephen Hawking.
Right. So, what were we talking about? Yeah, we were talking about the expansion of the universe, right?
Expansion,
all galaxies seem to be moving away from our galaxy. Right, and obviously we are not the bad guy or something like that. So the other question is, are we at the center of the universe so that when the universe expands, all of the galaxies seem to be moving away? That's the other question.
Yeah.
So Hubble looked at it and he actually found we don't seem to be at the center, because every galaxy seems to be moving away from every other galaxy.
Yeah.
Calculate this. So
there is not a reference point by which it is something else.
Yeah. Ever since Copernicus, or even before that, whoever said Earth is not at the center, we have been losing our significance.
I just wanted to interrupt you, Babu. See, this expansion or contraction, whatever that may be. Whether it is producing some sound or something like that, expansion, every expansion, the gas is expanding, the material is expanding, expansion, each and every expansion produces sound. So, could you say that there is a sound for the universe? So you are speaking about two-dimensional kind of things, space and, you know, the size and space, two-dimensional, we can say roughly as a language, two-dimensional, space and distance, I mean, the size and distance. So can you give some light on the background sound of the universe? do you expect there is some sound between?
So the in a very physical sense, in a very physical sense, the answer to that question is yes, at least at some point in the history of the universe.
Ooh.
And I will come to that, and it has played a very crucial role in our understanding.
Okay.
And it's going to be a very physical argument. It's not going to be a spiritual line or anything like that. Yeah. It's going to be a very thorough basic physics argument, which has nailed down some fundamental questions. We will come to that maybe in a couple of slides.
Okay.
Okay. So before we move on to that, I just wanted to make sure that we understand the nature of this expansion, right? What I typically do is, because there are questions that we may come across, maybe Priyamada or others. So this is a kind of a one-dimensional universe that I use for demonstration, and the paper clips are galaxies, okay. They are at some distances from each other, okay. Now when the universe expands, let me just step back a little bit.
Yeah.
I'm stepping back a little bit. The universe is expanding. You can see that the distances between the different galaxies are increasing, right?
It's increasing.
Now you can also see that the farther away, like these two galaxies are receding from each other faster than the near the farther away these two galaxies are,
expand. The distance between these two things are, you know, more than that, the center one.
Right. So
it's a good example, yeah. Very nice example.
You can now think, okay. Let's say you take this you extend this very long. I mean, I don't know, you can take element like a mile long or 10,000 mile long. You can think about this, right? So there may be galaxies that are so far away that they are receding from us at faster than the speed of light.
Oh.
Isn't it?
That is also possible.
Yes. So there are galaxies that are moving away from us from us faster than the speed of light. I mean, but then we do have a policeman in the universe, right? Albert Einstein. He said, "No, there is a speed limit. Thou shalt not cross." See.
Okay.
Einstein said, "You cannot go faster than the speed of light, which is 300,000 kilometers per second, or 186,000 miles per second." So is this the violation of Einstein's special relativity? The special relativity is where he has come up with this law, I mean. So apparently it's not. Because what Einstein prohibits is nothing can move relative to you. Like nothing can cross your nose faster than the speed of light. But space itself can expand faster than the speed of light, carrying the stuff in it along it.
Oh.
Yes.
It is only exemption.
There is no exemption. This doesn't violate it at all. Nothing can move through space faster than the speed of light. But space itself can expand faster than the speed of light. That's not a violation. The reason I mentioned it, that you might think about it, or you might read somewhere, or in some books or some questions, it's not an exemption. Okay. The law applies only for things that move through space. Things that move in space. And it doesn't apply for space itself.
Indirectly, this can be said, well said, like this, like, you know, the power behind the holding of the universe or upkeeping of the universe itself has got the authority to do whatever it wishes. Correct? It could be in the form of expansion.
I don't want to use that terminology of superpower controlling it, but you can think of it like if there is a superpower who is controlling all this, these are the rules of the game that power is using.
Okay.
Typically when you do this, don't want to bring in the notion of some controlling authority that is doing it, because that argument you can use anywhere and use to explain anything. But at least in science, you don't tend to use it. Because that argument can be brought even for, why the Earth is rotating or things like that. And then you don't need to ask any more questions once you accept that as a valid argument or valid answer, then there are no further questions.
Correct.
Right. So this is where science needs to ask questions, and that's how things go. Okay. So all right. So I think that was about the expansion itself. Any more questions on the expansion?
No, expansion, I was having the question of sound.
I'll come to that. When generally, if there is no medium, there is no sound. That's the general idea. Okay, so, but there is a special case where sound has come to answer some good questions. We'll come to that. So when you watch the Star Wars movie, if you did, and you can see their firing weapons and its laser weapons and things exploding and all that, and with sound, that's just for the audience. It's not real, because sound cannot travel in vacuum. Okay. So, I wanted to show you this. Do you have YouTube there?
Yeah.
The nature of expansion. Okay. Do you recognize this person?
Hawkins?
No, this is not Hawkins. This is Woody Allen.
Oh, the cartoon fellow.
Movie and he's.
He's an old, yeah.
Yeah. So I will post this on the chat window, but I will also play here. Okay. There is a chat window. I'm going to play this, okay?
Okay.
How the heck do you get to YouTube? Can you see this? Are you able to see this? So, were you able to see this?
To be honest with you, no. There was some conflict. Now we could.
Now you can. Let me play this again.
Yeah.
So were you able to see that video?
Yeah.
You were, okay. Okay, so Harvey is obviously depressed. He lives in Brooklyn, which is a neighborhood in New York City. And he learned that the universe is expanding and everything is getting ripped apart. You know, things are going to end. And what's the point in doing homework? He doesn't want to go to school. Right? Yeah. So and the mom is right. Mom says, what has the universe got to do with it? You live in Brooklyn, and Brooklyn is not expanding. And that is true. The expansion of the universe is only, that only affects things that are, or space that is separated by several millions of light years. The things of the size of the Earth or the Sun or the solar system or even our galaxy, that's not affected by this expansion.
Okay.
Only millions and millions of light years distance, that's what is affected by the expansion. I mean, just to give a kind of a speed on the expansion, the latest measurements from the Planck satellite from the European Space Agency, it is measuring about 69 or 70 kilometers per second.
Ooh.
For a distance of 325 million light years. Yeah. So space that is separated by, it's called a megaparsec, 3.26 megaparsec. One megaparsec, that's 3.26 million light years. The galaxies that are separated by that distance, they have an expansion component of 70 kilometers, approximately 69 or 70 kilometers per second. And the greater the distance, the greater that. You know, double the distance will be double the speed. That's the expansion velocity of the universe. Okay, so we don't have to worry about it. Earth is not expanding, solar system is not expanding, we are not going to get ripped apart from the sun, or our sun and solar system is not going to get ripped away from the galaxy or anything like that. Okay. So I think that is the basic treatment of depression expansion. Okay, so you can actually think of this. Here is Tara says, this guy is my hero.
Is he the one, like, you have the two books that were written by him?
Yeah.
Yeah, hero.
So he even sent an autograph book, okay? So let me just show you. One of the two books, and he actually has. But I put this picture here years before I got the book. Okay, so so Meb Keflezighi, that's his name. He is the first American to win an Olympic marathon medal in something like 25 years. He's the first American to win the New York City Marathon in 34 years.
Ooh.
And many years later, the Boston Marathon also after similar time scale. So his picture is well recognized here by the audience, so I put that here. So this is the New York City Marathon in 2012, maybe. So, yeah. So this is about the expansion itself. So you can see that all these runners are scattered along the course, right?
Yeah.
And towards the finish line, when you come, you see that there is more and more separation or whatever. But now, if you play the movie backward, you can see that they will start getting closer and closer. And at the starting point, there's a starting point you will see where all runners had the same start time and they were all together. Just like a marathon. Similarly, when you, if you play the expansion of the universe backward, what we see is that everything we can see, all the galaxies that are so far away, they were all right on top of each other or something like that at some point in time.
Okay.
So they all had a very compact beginning. Or some sort of a starting point, like 12 to 14 billion years ago. That's what this shows. So this is the beginning. What it's, it, everything seems to have started from a very small and dense state, and
okay,
kind of got launched with a very high expansion rate. Okay. And this is, this event is called the Big Bang. Actually, the Big Bang was not a term the people who worked on this or developed this theory used. This was used by a British astronomer called Fred Hoyle to put down this theory in one of his interviews. He was a proponent of steady state universe and things are not changing. That it's one of those variants of that theory. He didn't believe that the universe is expanding, and so when you turn it backward, it was in a more condensed state. So he kind of, he was mocking that theory as a Big Bang.
Yeah.
But that name stuck.
Yeah.
Okay. But so it is actually now called the Big Bang Theory officially also. So it has stood the test of time, and there is very strong evidence to this. Everything started from a very small, dense, and hot state and got launched with a very high velocity. Okay. So from a theory point of view, this is what it shows or what it says. How space and matter in it evolve with time. And it is based on Einstein's general relativity and the cosmological principle. The cosmological principle we saw a few slides ago, that the universe is
isotropic.
Yeah, homogeneous and isotropic, which means the universe is smooth and it looks the same in all directions and in all places. Einstein actually assumed that as a simplifying assumption, so that he can write the work on the theory. Because Einstein's general relativity is the one that links space and gravity and matter in a way that it was, there was another scientist called Wheeler who actually said, Einstein's theory basically says, matter tells space how to curve, and space tells matter how to move.
Hmm.
So I think that was a very condensed statement of how it is. And the theory applied to the universe is the Big Bang Theory.
Okay.
So we don't want to get into too much of detail there, but I will show you some inkling of what it looks like. But before that, Big Bang was a big controversial theory, right? So what is the evidence of that? First evidence is the expansion of the universe itself. If universe is expanding, yeah, it means that it was smaller in the past, and when you play it backward, it all had a dense and small beginning. The other evidence is, apparently the physics involved at that stage, the early universe, is very well known, nuclear physics. So you can actually predict the exact amount of, at least the relative abundances of elements that are created in the initial state. How much of hydrogen, how much of helium, and some other lithium and other trace elements. It happens, it so happens that 75% of the matter created is hydrogen, about 25% is helium, and a few other elements in very trace quantities. So when scientists looked all over the universe, they measured the abundance of hydrogen and helium, and they matched the prediction. Because this is based on known particle and nuclear physics. Okay. Then there was another prediction. If there was such a big bang, a hot, dense state from which everything just came up, then we must still see the afterglow of that bang. It must still be present.
Okay.
That was another prediction. Okay. By the way, this bang itself, sometimes media and all, they talk about this as an explosion, like a bomb exploding or something. So the bang itself is not an explosion in space. What we want to remember is this is happening everywhere, not just, you know, in one place or in a localized region. It's happening everywhere, large scale, small scale, everywhere it is happening.
Yeah.
And it is not an explosion into or expansion into pre-existing space. It is creating the very space itself it is expanding into. That's something hard to get our heads around.
Mm-hmm.
It is creating the space itself that it is going to expand into, or it is expanding into. And it's happening everywhere, even the tiniest scales to the largest scales. It's just happening there. Okay. So, where was I? All right, so if there was such a hot, dense state, then we must see its afterglow. And due to the expansion of the universe, that afterglow, which means radiation, which was very powerful at the time, all in, you know, created in gamma ray and then stressed out into visible light and all that, now it must be in microwave. That was the prediction. For several years, people forgot about the prediction, and then someone in Princeton dusted out that, and they also independently predicted it, and they were planning to look for it in the 60s. Okay. So this is how things happen. Sometimes in science, there were two engineers, Robert Wilson and Arno Penzias, in New Jersey here. They were working for Bell Labs, and here is an antenna that they were testing for microwave communication. So they were, actually this antenna is still there, and some of the people I know, they went to clean it out and refurbish it. It is functional, but it's not connected to anything.
Okay.
Yeah, you can still see it. They won Nobel Prize for this, actually.
Okay, fine.
So what they did was they were trying to test microwave communication, and they were getting noise, a low level of noise in the equipment, no matter what they did. They thought it was coming from their, some of the electrical circuitry, or they checked everything and it wasn't. Then maybe they thought it was coming from some other structures or some buildings somewhere. It wasn't. They turned the antenna in all directions, and it was still coming. It was not coming from a particular direction. Then they saw that there was some pigeon droppings in the antenna, and these two guys just climbed into it and cleaned and washed the whole thing. But they were not able to eliminate it. They were simply not able to eliminate it. So someone actually told them, hey, there is this group in Princeton. They were saying something about the sky, and there is some radiation that might come in the microwave band, which is probably where you may want to talk to them. So one afternoon they gave a call to Princeton and got in touch with, I think the scientist's name was Dickey. He was having a group meeting about how to start an investigation into this, and he picked up the phone and he kept the phone down and said, we have been scooped.
Mm-hmm.
But Wilson and Penzias didn't know that the significance of this. But you know, they once they realized this was the metaphorical smoking gun evidence for the Big Bang. They found that there is a radiation at about, I don't recall the microwave frequency, but the energy is like 2.7 degrees Kelvin. It's coming from everywhere in the sky. It is smooth, and they got to know. So the temperature, what they measured was here. Actually, this is coming from other experiments. They saw that this entire sky has a smooth microwave background, which is the first light coming from the birth of the universe. Now, we might have seen it also. If you turn the TV on between stations, you might see some static. About 5 or 10% of the static is the microwave background. So you can see that you have seen the birth of the universe.
Perfect.
So, here is the spectrum itself of the intensity of the radiation at different frequencies or temperature scales. This matched the theoretical predictions exactly, and for measuring the spectrum, another person from New Jersey also got Nobel Prize. John Mather.
Oh, I brought back that. Oh, sorry, the presentation.
Tara, you might want to, I'll mute her.
What's going on?
I'm muting Tara.
The presentation?
Okay. So the temperature had a peak of 2.72 degrees because the original temperature was about 3,000 degrees. It got redshifted into 2.7 degrees due to the expansion. So one question was that if the universe was like this in the beginning, if everything was smooth, how could anything form? Because the stars and galaxies form from gravity. Gravity needs to be able to attract and pull matter together, right? Only then there can be anything. So if everything is so smooth, nothing could have formed.
Yeah.
So there was another satellite launched to measure this more accurately, and it did find some deviations, minute deviations. It's called anisotropies, tiny fluctuations. These tiny fluctuations are of the order of one part in 100,000. So this picture is highly exaggerated.
Yeah.
So these tiny fluctuations in density and temperature, they are the seeds for forming stars and galaxies in the subsequent universe. Yes. So this is called, you can think of it as the embryonic universe. So when you look at the sky in the night, you see the dark sky behind the stars. But this is what you should imagine. Instead of the dark sky, if you had microwave sensitive eyes, this is what you will see.
Yeah.
Behind all the stars and galaxies and everything, this is the background, and not, we cannot see behind what was behind this visually. So these regions, I forget whether this false color, the red one is showing denser regions or the blue ones, but whichever it is, these tiny fluctuations allow gravity to work on the denser regions. Gravity in the denser regions will pull matter from the less dense regions.
Yeah.
And matter can grow there. So in many of these, in all these places, this is how structure grew. Denser regions got more denser, and you know, rarer regions got rarer. And finally, things were pulling together, gas clouds and all that were able to form, and stars and galaxies came up. So this is our, another thing is, yeah, this was an example of the sky here 2 days ago. When we see the something like this, you know, clouds, this is sort of a scattered surface, right? The photons were created in the sun maybe 10,000 to even 100,000 years ago. They were trapped inside the sun, but they escaped, and finally they got scattered from this clouds, and we see the clouds. This cloud is the last surface of scattering for those photons. Similarly, the photons that we are seeing here were created at the first instant of the universe's birth. There were about a billion protons to a proton at the time. But all that was locked up inside the dense plasma, because plasma is electrically charged, not neutral. Protons and electrons are separated, so, and the photons actually react with them, so they kind of bounce around. But only after the universe expanded and cooled to a level where electrons could bind to protons and form hydrogen and helium and all that, neutral atoms, that is when the photons were free to move. Until then, it was kind of foggy. So we are seeing the last surface of scattering here, once the fog cleared. At this time, the temperature was probably around 3,000 degrees, like the surface of the sun. But since then, the universe expanded and the light got weaker, lost energy, and today we are seeing this at 2.7 degrees. Okay. This is also, this also happens to be a gold mine of information. Okay. So this is where you might see something. One of the fundamental questions that people have always asked, even about the Earth, is how big is the Earth, right? So Eratosthenes, I think it was Eratosthenes, it was a famous experiment he did.
Eratosthenes.
Right, he, Cyene or some city in Egypt and Alexandria, which was separated by 700 miles, and he knew that the sun would be overhead in one location at a certain time, so he used a pole or a post at another location to measure the shadow.
Yeah.
And he measured the angle.
Right?
And using basic geometry, he was able to measure the curvature of the Earth and then the shape of the Earth. Or, I mean, by then the Earth was round. That was well known. But he could measure the radius of the Earth. But so size and shape is one of the fundamental questions that we have always asked. So here, this is a geometry about the shape of the universe. Let's say that we have a universe that is positively curved, like a sphere. If we draw a triangle on it, how can you determine if something is flat or non-flat? That's a basic question when it comes to shape. So the lowest picture is the flat geometry, where if you measure measure angles on a triangle, you will see they add up to 180 degrees, right? It's basic geometry. If it's negatively curved, then the angles will add up to less than 180 degrees. And if it's positively curved, they will add up to more than 180 degrees. Right? Priyamvada, that's clear?
Yeah, that's clear.
Are you still awake?
Yeah, Priyamvada is having classes tomorrow.
Oh, is it? Oh, it's Sunday?
So she was a bit worried, and she just don't want to lose the, the session.
So, does she have classes Sunday? Does she have classes on
Yeah. Even all days, like all holidays.
Oh, wow. So in that case, why don't we stop this and maybe we'll pick it up some other day?
Sure, yeah.
Okay.
That's possible. If that is not a difficulty for you, I mean, it's not a botheration for you, then that would be appreciable.
No, we can do this later.
Yeah. How many slaves do we have balance?
I don't know. Maybe about another 30 or 25 or something.
Oh, okay. That's okay.
So better go to sleep and then we'll catch up later.
No, it's not the question of sleeping. She wanted to prepare for tomorrow's classes.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah. Actually, she is having classes from 10 to 3:30 in the regular school, and from 4:30 to 7:30 in the